Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Find light in the beautiful sea. I chose to be happy. You and I, you and I. We're like diamonds in the sky. You're a shooting star I see. A vision of ecstasy. When you hold me, I'm alive. We're like diamonds in the sky. I knew that we'd become one right away. Oh, right away. At first sight, I felt the energy of some things. I saw the life inside.
So shine bright tonight. You and I, we're
program. He is no other than Dr. Astell Collins. Dr. Astell Collins is here to tell us more about his leadership program and what he intends to do in Guyana, and also he's spreading his wings wide and abroad. He's now in the New York area and he has visited several churches, and he is expected to be in Washington to receive a special award in Washington, D.C. So once again, we welcome Dr. Astell Collins to Thoughts and Teams program. He will give me some leadership because I do need some leadership advice. I need some leadership because of my children's program. So I will welcome him to our Thoughts and Teams program. Dr. Astell Collins, you're neither a top or a team, but you're just right for this program. So welcome once again. And first of all, we ask you to introduce yourself once again to our television program, because you are a well-known author, professor, director, and you will give us some more of your introduction.
Thank you very much. Well, but for the audience who are now seeing me, my journey started when I left there to go to South Africa, where I spent 4 years, 6 months, and after doing a number of years of training from the government to the combat industry, South Africa's highest national award, which ranks me as one of the most influential as an citizen. It's now the time that Dr. Monroe, who passed away last year this time, he was the one who actually encouraged me to return to Guyana to give back. And in celebration of his honor and his legacy, it was 60 years that he lived and passed, so I've dedicated 60 seminars to his honor. So I've been back in Guyana, and now it's close to 400 seminars that I've done in the past 3 years. And so me being in the West is just in response to the demand that has been created over the years, because I think this is my eighth time in the U.S. and I've been doing a lot of leadership training, and that's why you mentioned about Washington, D.C. I'm actually supposed to be receiving the Global Leadership Award in Washington from the IKEA Ministry. But I'm very passionate about Guyana and giving back as much as I can. I was saying earlier that from the time the new president was elected, I have done close to 100 seminars. And this is the schools, the prisons, teachers, various youth organizations. And my passion has allowed me to do relentlessly, and without fear or favor, to continue to impart in our youth. And I believe that Guyana has the greatest underutilized resources in our youth. But if they don't know that,
I'm glad that you said about Guyana, because I know a lot of people, when they go to Guyana, they complain about attitude and moral values of our young people. And not only in Guyana you have this type of problem, you have it all over the world. But you know, Guyana is our main sources, our main country, our birth, and we love it dearly. And when we hear people talk about, you know, the attitude of our young people, and when people get there, the way they perform, you know, it makes us feel very, very, very bad, because that is our country. We want to know that tourism have the opportunity to be in Guyana, according to Dr. Kathy Hughes, Minister Kathy Hughes, and she's the tourism minister. And it would be a problem if we don't have that part of it dedicated, or the moral values enhanced for tourism. Because if we're going to promote tourism in our country, we need to have the moral values of our young people. We need to have the respect for tourists. So when tourists go there, they are well respected, and they can come back and say, yes, we had a good time in Guyana. Our meeting and greeting with the Guyanese community, meeting and greeting with business people or our salesperson was very, very much beautiful, and they would want to go back there. We don't want them to come back and say they would not be going back there. So,
and you see, you talk there about attitude. And attitude is a product of belief. No man can live beyond the limits of his belief. So I believe that we have to instill in our young people a sense of value. I often ask in my seminar, what is the difference between a diamond and a pebble? And the diamond is more valuable simply because the diamond is rare. And out of 600 million for ourselves, we were chosen. So I try to give a message whereby the young people understand who they are, you know, and who they are, and how they can embrace their individuality. You see, the opposite of courage is not fear. The opposite of courage is conformity. One of the greatest challenges in life is to be yourself in a world that is trying to make it like everyone else. It was Maya Angelou who said, without courage, you cannot practice any other virtue consistently. You cannot be consistently kind, consistently fair, consistently just. And I believe it takes courage for us to be ourselves. But you cannot love oneself without first knowing oneself. So it's really a journey of self-discovery. And when I talk about leadership, it's not leadership in the aspect of being a position or a title, but leadership in you taking the necessary time to discover who you are, refine who you are, and then being of service. It was Martin Luther King who says, not everyone can be famous, but everyone can be great, because greatness is a matter of service. So you have to instill in our young people the spirit of not servitude, but servanthood.
I know that you're talking about the young people. And yes, we must instill the moral values. We must enhance them with the values of leadership. But what about the parents? Because, you know, these sentiments or these programs is not only for young people.
Yeah.
It should be given to parent and child relationship, because what you have taught the child here, and the child go home and the parent is not involved, that will be a catastrophe. Because I know with my program back home, I never have a child without the parents is not involved.
Okay.
So when the parents is involved, I know the values that I'm teaching that child, the parents will able to continue, because first thing they return and say, don't let me tell Miss Trim how you're behaving.
Okay.
And nobody wants to know that they can get on the television program. Yeah. They don't want to know, the children don't want to know they can. So the values was there with the parents, teaching them at the same time. So when we teach all these programs, yes, you're doing a wonderful job, but it's time that we take the parents, grandparents, and every, so when that child returns to that home, or that teenager returns to that home, that values is being passed down, and it's an egg being laid and hatched, and a lot of chickens are being flying about because the parents are involved, or the family dynamics, dynamics. It's producing a better family, and that's the way we change. Yes, we can change our young people. When they meet on the road, it's a different story.
Yeah.
When they meet home, it's a different story. So, and then they're watching television, they're getting ideas, they're getting communication, which they think that the outer world is doing something good for them. But it's not. But if they have the moral values in the home of itself, and I think the president of Guyana needs to say, every parent, you have to have this type of leadership, because without you, our children will be failure.
And I believe he understands that. The thing is, when you talk about parents, they had an issue with, I think, two major secondary schools in Guyana. I was brought in. And what I did was to ask for the parents and the teachers to form a moral contract, whereby there's no casting of blame, but there's a shared responsibility. The child can only be as good. Well, the teachers have to work with what is being brought to the school, mm-hmm. and not the teachers alone being responsible for raising that child. So I brought back the responsibility of the parents, and the thing is, it is not what the parents say or do, but it's their actions. Our kids are watching our actions as a moral compass. So when we believe that it is do as I say and not as I do, mm-hmm. it has to be a resurrection of consciousness whereby we are responsible in our actions, in our daily activities. And you also touched on the eggs. And a lot of I often ask my participants, are you an egg or a potato? And I said, if I throw an egg on the ground, the egg breaks. If I throw a potato on the ground, it bounces. But you see, life that is represented in hot water. If you put both the egg and the potato in hot water, boiling hot water, you take the egg out and it gets hard. Mm. You take the potato out, it gets soft. So life is really measured in how you become after life, or after trials, after tribulations. It's not when nothing happens, it's but how do I respond to challenges? And we are faced with many challenges, but are we adequately equipped to deal with these challenges? You see, most of us are. Recently I did a seminar on abuse, and we often think about abuse as the perpetrator and the victim. But I take it another level, whereby ignorance of purpose leads to inevitable abuse. If I have not taken the necessary time to discover who I am, mm-hmm. why I'm here, and what is the destiny that made me necessary, even though I might be successful, I am likely to be abused simply because I am not doing that which I was created to do. You see, the graveyard is the richest part of life. And we are literally like walking treasure chests. We are born with a responsibility to give to our generation, to give to our time. That is God has deposited in us. Mm-hmm. The fact that we are alive is a testimony that there is a destiny that made us necessary. But we are going to inadvertently enrich the grave if we don't take the necessary time to uncover what it is that is my talent, my ability, my gift, my strength. What it is that God has blessed me so with life, that I am responsible for giving to this generation. This is like a puzzle. If you see yourself as a puzzle, and there's only one spot from a particular piece of puzzle, only when you find your spot can you stand out. If you find most of us, because there's an identity crisis, we tend to wear other people.
So the puzzle in our life is that the puzzle is coming that parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles, is not fitted in to the puzzle so that we can really work on our children. But let me say this. The attitude of parents or the attitude of the community has to raise the child. And if a child could go wrong and hear the verbal abuse, the verbal talking of, you know, a lot of people believe that when they use abusive words, it sounds good in a conversation. They feel that they got to use the phrases, I call it the phrases of Guyana, the phrases. And when we use those phrases in the community, a child passing, the child will get it, and the child will go with it, and it becomes a normal attitude for a child hearing. What I think, and what I do think, that the government of Guyana should put on it should put on a leash on the tongue of people when they are using indecent language. There should be a penalty, because that's the way it will stop. Because when you heard, like just like how they got the police going wrong, now we hear they have police going wrong charging people for garbage, thanks to the Facebook and everybody who likes up the Facebook, and especially me who blasts the government about the Dorothy thing. They have done a wonderful job. And I know that I was in Guyana, in St. Lucia, and I never forget it. If you go into my bag, it's garbage full, because I don't throw anything on the road. I was fined $25 to drop in an icicle bag St. Lucia Road. Yes, and it hurt me. So no matter where I go, I always remember that. And if they can do that, they can put a lid, they can put a leash on the tongues of Guyanese community in Guyana, because they just involve themselves in abusive language all the time. Children passing, they feel it is okay that they can behave like that. Even in America here, not that I don't like the Guyanese community, but I don't like the verbal expression that they use when they gather together. It just makes me, I didn't like people to curse me. I didn't like the curse, you know. I was very hurtful when I was cursing. I know that I did it to myself or to my children or whatever. But then as you grow older, then you realize, but I didn't like it. I really didn't like it.
Law literally creates culture.
Mm-hmm.
If we have a law that is so relaxed, it encourages a certain type of behavior. So yes, law may have, it will have a direct impact on the way we behave. But to me, it must not necessarily come from the ambit or the parameters of law. But we, in our own homes, will have that sense of decency and dignity, whereby we carry ourselves differently. And under this new dispensation, there should be a renewed vigor, a renewed, you know, outlook on life. And how do we, as a nation, become better ambassadors, realizing that each and every one of us are representing our nation wholeheartedly. So it's how do we, as a nation, come together? There must be a coming together. And we must be submitted to one vision. And it's in our motto, one people, one nation, one destiny. My ambition, especially in my seminar, is to how do we become one? A house divided cannot stand. And our young people are literally looking at how we, the adults, are behaving. And if they believe that national unity is not a reality, or would never be a reality, they would not consistently be developing efforts or developing attitudes that would ensure that it becomes a reality. So I believe that the adults have to model and not just say, but to be what it is that they are aspiring to be. I mean, Guyana has now, under the new administration, I believe there's an honest effort to really bring Guyana up, you know, and their efforts in terms of cleaning the place. So I believe there will be laws in place to actually create that culture of cleanliness and for us to dissuade from littering. But I believe it has to be a consistent effort, not just the policymakers, but as you rightfully pointed out, it must start in our home. It must start in our home.
You know, in America, you abuse a child, you curse a child, you get jailed. Because if that child goes and says something, my mother did this or my father did this, you know they come in and kick down your door and get you. I think, I'm not saying that the doors must be kicked down, but the policy can be made. The policy can be made for the community. The policy can be made for the parents. Policy can be made for the schools. The language that they use enticed the children, and the children became very violent because using those words, as a child, I never used those words. I never had to use it. My mother was like that, and I was so mad because I couldn't take it and I wouldn't use dirty language.
Yeah.
But having my children and having a relationship with my ex-husband, you know, it really make you get very violent. But I'm going to tell you, since I'm in America, you never find me using any words. It's not a part of me. It's not a part that I would like, something that I detest. But, you know, the situation of anger makes this happen. So, you know, and we're not knowledgeable, because if it is being a law that you cannot be such verbal abuse in your home or wherever you are, even on the streets, what are you going on with? It will stop because they know, here is a charge. Here I got to pay a fine. Here I got to control myself. It's all because lack of control of the government causes lack of control of the community, and lack of control of the community causes lack of control of parents and child relationships. You agree. Oh, let us go to something else now. I know that your programs, you could tell us some more about your programs that you did. And what is the leadership? What do you really say to these young people to get them to understand the real leadership? Because we all saying leadership, and some of them might be saying, oh, you have to be a president, you have to be a prime minister, you have to be a minister in the government. But leadership is not only being the minister of the government, that who will clean the streets?
Right.
Who will cut the grass? Who will take care of the garbage? Who will be the caterers, the cooks? So that is the type of leadership that we need to enforce now in our young people. That's not only that we're going to have a GCE or a CXE, because I always believe a child may have the ability to do a CXE now. Another child may not have the ability to do the CXE now. But the thing about it, and what should be enforced in leadership, is that education is an ongoing process. It's not when you leave school finished. Yeah. It's an ongoing process, because you find that some people who may not be able to achieve that brilliancy at a young, tender age can do many other things, and they will be able to adapt themselves into education field that they can do it for their studies in a later date. Some people who was never a bookworm or look like a scholar has become great people, educators, because of the late development. And that is something needs to be told. There are early developers and there are late developers, and we need to help them and give them that in your leadership program, because you are doing the leadership program in Guyana. Don't give them the focus that, if you don't have that education, you can't move forward.
But it's interesting that you would say that, because one aspect of my leadership is to really demystify even what education is.
Mm-hmm.
See, education is not the learning of facts. It's rather the training of the mind to think. Mm-hmm. And I help them to understand how powerful, the most powerful thing we have is an idea.
Mm-hmm.
And I ask the question, whose ideas are governing our lives?
Mm-hmm.
The worst problem was ideological. And God sent an opposing idea in the form of Christ. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was with God. Was God, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Words are literally containers of ideas.
Mm-hmm.
Everything we see, touch, feel, everything we experience was once an idea. The Facebook that we now can't live without. 20 years ago, it was not there. And all that Mark Zuckerberg did was to manifest an idea.
We had to ring the phone and wait on the telegram.
So I help people to understand. You see, the education system has done a disservice to us. If you see, it's like you have a group of animals. You have a lion, you have a giraffe, you have an elephant, you have a fish, you have a monkey. Mm. If you now say that all we need to do is one test, and the education system has tricked the minds of our young people looking for specific subjects, as if we're looking for gold and diamond, we look for math. It's like if you tell a fish, you have to climb a tree.
Mm-hmm.
And here's education level is based on his ability to climb a tree. That fish will spend his entire life feeling like he's stupid because he's incapable of climbing a tree. And that is how we have gotten our young people. You see, we've almost educated them out of their creativity.
Mm-hmm.
If a child is naturally gifted at dancing, we don't teach dancing as we teach math.
Mm-hmm.
If they're naturally gifted at art, we don't teach art as we would do math and English. So we need to not reform, but revolutionize the education system.
Reframe
and what we believe that we are equipping the next generation to deal with the circumstances that we have today. Because the dogmas of the quiet past are inadequate for the stormy present. So we have to not reshuffle, but really revolutionize how we look and view education and educate the entire man, not just public areas. Because you find when you come out of school, there's certain things that you've learned you would never apply, you would never use.
I can't remember.
You see? And that is most cases. And we have to teach self-concept, self-esteem, self-worth. But once you find you have a lot of educated people, master's degree but hate themselves, doctorate degree but hate themselves. You know how dangerous it is for a man who is highly skilled, highly educated, but is self-hated.
You know, I'm glad you used that word, ID.
Okay.
Because, you know, I was very good at school, but not at top.
Yeah.
And I had a teacher by the name of Miss Rampersad. And Miss Rampersad stoke your skin with lashes in your hand until you see that table. That table from 1 to 12, and then you go upwards, and I think I never forget it. Because every time I go to add and subtract, I remember her. I remember Miss Hector give you lashes for spelling. So I never wanted to be at the bottom. I always try to be at the head because you have to play victim, victim. If I go down to the bottom, I'm crying because you know the lashes that you will get. But what I'm saying to you is that people want you to have this big set of degree because you cannot get a job. But in my own way, I find that once you can spell, once you can add, subtract, divide, you got the basic. You understand me? You got the basic. And today, we are not doing that because of technology.
Yes.
Technology is adding, subtract, and divide for us. And that is killing it because, you know, I would spell from, spell in syllables. You remember you used to song in words, you used to song. Now you're not sounding that word because I write a lot of with the text on the text. If you are spelling the right word, but because the text is coming out, sometimes you don't even look to see what because these different things push up itself and the wrong word go and you look like if you're spelling, but you are spelling the right word. But because of the technology that they have here now, they put several words, and then you check to say, well, clock on that one because you spelled the right word. And that is what I'm saying. The technology now is destroying the ability to read, to spell, and to even to spell in songs.
Yes.
Because everything we do on the computer. And the computer is programmed now to spell for us. So our brains, that brain cell, it becomes very lazy. You know, sometimes I'm trying to spell, is this word right? Because, you know, you see so much of the words at the same time, and that is causing a hinder progress in learning development in the manual form. In you learning development now in the technology, and even the little babies, the one that gets computer. In later age, we'll be having no person to do syllable sounds anymore. They won't even know to spell unless they go to check the computer, check the thing, spell check. So you're not spelling anymore. You're just watching words and say. And I have that problem when I'm doing my program in America. And I boast about my children in Guyana, and I said they can spell and they can do this. But I have that problem in America. These children can call the biggest words that you can find because they've seen it and the thing. But when you pull away that book and you ask them to spell, they cannot spell that word. So there is a great problem. They only know the words that they see. And I can tell because when I call in words for them to write, they, when I take the book and I see, they say, wow. I mean, I'm getting lazy now because me, I'm depending now on the computer. My brain's this thing, and you know, I got to write so many letters, and asking and sending out this and sending out that, and the computer just gave me the word, and I'm not even checking. Sometimes you go back and you check on your eyesight, you're not seeing. I'm old lady now, so you got to excuse me with that. So how would you focus on helping those people like me to be good leadership? Some of them may not have the bachelor's degree or the degree or whatever they're calling for, but they may have the, as we said, the elderly people still have knowledge.
Yeah. You see, there's a misconception that
yes.
you need a degree
mm-hmm.
to be perceived as intelligent or educated.
Mm-hmm.
When we understand what education really is, you find a lot of people who are not degreed, but they are better equipped.
Mm-hmm.
to deal with life and life circumstances. So I believe that we should demystify what education really is. And you see, all I try to get the young people to understand is their personal value,
mm-hmm.
their individuality. How do they take the necessary time to discover who they are? You see, ignorance of purpose leads to the inevitable of business.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, you can be successful or you would successfully acquire a specific degree. But if it is not, because my associate degree was medical technology, but what I'm doing now is nothing, I'm doing nothing
okay,
with myself.
Sure.
So you have to be content to discover who you are and be the best that you are supposed to be. But we find that we have great originals who have settled to becoming cheap copies.
Mm-hmm.
You see the lion, who is by nature king of the jungle. He is now caged, and he remains caged in his mind.
And we had a way of telling children, shut up, let me speak. you not to speak. What, every child born with their own individual gift. And we have to give that child that opportunity to use their gift. And my program that I had is that you have to use your gift. What is your gift? Let me see what is your gift. Not mine, but yours, the child, so the child could develop. And I feel good when I see children on the internet and say, Miss Trim, I was in your program. And Miss Trim, you taught me this and you taught me that. And, you know, they come out very successful. Some parents say, man, you made my dream, because I also tell them, you know, when you go on that television, you become a role model. The things I used to do, I do no more. You understand? So that is it. And it's very good having you here. But before you go, give me a little bit of advice before our time run out.
He who knows not and knows not that he knows not is a fool. He who knows not and knows that he knows not is a child. Teach him. He who knows and knows not that he knows is asleep waking. But he who knows and knows that he knows is a wise man.
Okay, well, you know, Patricia Trim knows and knows and knows and knows. So, it was so nice talking with Dr. Astell Collins, giving us more information. We will have more talk with him. But from Touching Teams, we're going to say goodbye for now. And we love you all. And, you know, take a picture of his words and use it, and you will be wise. This is Touching Teams in Focus, saying goodbye with Patricia Trim and Dr. Astell Collins. We love you.
Shine bright like a diamond. So shine bright.